Given like this very strange world that we are living in with a lot of uncertainty, what would be like the next step for you to make, and how can you make it? Like, is it going to be in terms of signing a player or change of a coach?
I think signing players right now is more important, because you can see that the squad is not what is required to win the Premier League. So, like, it's not too far. They have depth in a lot of positions. Left back is a great position for depth. Right back should be better, but Aaron Wan-Bissaka needs somebody to compete with. In, like, I'm talking about best case scenario, not considering the current financial situation, because recruitment is going to be very hard. They don't have somebody to play right wing. Like, they need that winger. They need Sancho, in my opinion. They needed him last year, but they fucked it up, basically. And
playing the long waiting game, which
somebody in the center of the pitch, they need somebody very like, if we could put Matic in a time machine and put him 5 years back, that's a pretty good player to have.
Yeah,
he's still not perfect. Like, I'm not a huge fan of Nemanja Matic, but like, yeah, you need somebody like that. Like, and that's a hard player to figure out. Like, I think France has a tendency to produce players of that ilk. Like N'Golo Kante and the Blaise Matuidi and the guys that have come through in that position. And, so they need somebody to add a bit of steel and a bit of silkiness to the passing and the movement.
Yeah.
And I think Pogba is another thing they have to resolve. Like, is Pogba going to go? Is Pogba not going to go? I honestly think he should go, because it's the Lukaku situation from my perspective. It will be better for both sides if this transfer is completed and Pogba finally leaves Manchester United, because Lukaku has benefited immensely from leaving.
Yeah,
he was never the right fit, and looking back, it's quite obvious that he wasn't. And good on Lukaku, and all the accusation and the media pressure and all the nonsense that he had to face. I was part of that mob. That is why I feel really strongly about it. Yeah. I was never on board with Lukaku, and I was always like, whenever you see an article disparaging him, I'm like, yeah, these guys are right. Lukaku is not that good. But then you realize that sometimes it's not about how good or bad a player is. The circumstances surrounding them
and the environment
defines them more than their actual ability.
Yeah. And also the environment they're playing in.
Exactly. Yes. The environment, everything. Like, there's a lot of things, variables that people don't look at. That's the problem with football that I believe is there with football fans. Look at everything surrounding the guy. Like, people are talking about Timo Werner right now as if he's complete trash and he's not proven himself over and over and over and over again.
True.
For somebody who lives in Germany, you must have seen enough of Timo Werner to understand that he's an excellent footballer.
Yeah. I mean, and you don't pay 50 million.
And worse for Havertz. Havertz is 20 years old. Can you imagine being a 20-year-old living in London without any experience of London before?
In a new country,
in this environment where if you turn around the street, you are at risk of getting a virus that can destroy your career. Like, people do not empathize. They're not on pedestals. They're human beings. At least respect them as human beings.
Yeah.
And then the other problem with the lack of respect is, like, when the color of their skin changes,
I'm glad you brought that up.
Versus 10,000 times.
Yeah. Which is
like being Marcus Rashford. Like, that's the guy you put on a pedestal, because in a limited amount of time, he's able to do so much and for so many. And you have the balls to go on Instagram and say shit about him. It's
What have you done? Have you even done something for your own self?
What are you talking about? Like, who are you to tell him anything? Like, anybody suggesting Rashford should focus on football? Fuck you. He knows what he's doing, because he's the one who reached there. He knows how much work he's put in. He understands his journey, and he understands the pain and the sorrow and the hardships he's been through.
True.
You are nobody to tell him what choices he's supposed to make.
You're just being a dickhead behind your mobile phone, and driving shit.
You don't understand anything. You are living in your own fucking bubble, and you are pretending as if you understand what this guy who's been living in the United Quarters and however they set up these kids.
The community quarters.
In the academy.
Yeah.
He was 12 years old, man. He had to apply earlier than usual to be able to live in those circumstances, because it was hard for him to live at home and focus on his training. People don't I don't understand this. Like, this is, it's basic, man. Like, try and understand his perspective a little bit, just a little bit, and it'll make things much better.
Yeah, just, I mean, we are not even asking them to like put yourselves in their shoes, but
no,
just bring a little bit of empathy and, yeah.
A little bit. It's not much.
Picture yourself as a 20-year-old or as a 12-year-old and you having all the luxury of life through your parents. Since you already mentioned, like, as soon as the tone of the skin gets darker, the abuse gets heavier and meaner. And also,
like, let's just say what it is. It's racist.
Of course, like,
it's just racist. Like,
it's plain racism.
You don't have to describe it then.
The thing is, all these social media platforms, I still don't get it. Like, everybody says very verbally and very open that we are against the concept, we are against racism, but very few are doing anything. Like, now the people have been kneeling to bring about.
Very few that you found, man. Like, who are these people who have actually done? I think Swansea City is the first club that has actually taken a step. I don't know if it's enough. I don't know how much it counts for, but it's something.
Yeah, Swansea did something. And as soon as Liverpool's match versus Real, when Trent and Naby were abused, they also took a stand. Henderson released a message, but I think a lot of clubs will.
Messages, they don't do anything.
Yeah.
Man. Like, I'm not disparaging Henderson on any of these people who have put out messages. That I'm not. I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah.
But the problem is the messaging has value once it converts into action, right?
True.
And Henderson, from a personal perspective, like from what he can do, I think he's doing everything.
Sure.
The problem is, after a certain point of time, this kind of capitalist society we live in, individuals cannot make changes. Individuals cannot revolutionize the system. Like, the only example where the individual has actually made a huge, huge change is Marcus Rashford.
True.
Which is the most surprising thing of our times. Like, from a
he was doing more than what our prime minister the least a prime minister is supposed to do. So you can imagine the state of what.
Like, it's speaking out against the abuse. That's fine. But that doesn't help a person who's being abused, right?
True. Okay.
Like, I understand. Like, it helps to an extent. Like, I think Wilfred Zaha understands this and is able to put his.
Yes. I was just going to mention him that, yeah. Because now it normally seems that this is a match day routine, yeah? Players line up, take their positions before the whistle, and then they kneel. Yeah. Okay, why are we kneeling? Oh, it's just become a routine over 6 months, and maybe it's just going to continue for another 100 years without anything happening.
And the commentary is saying it means something. It means something. No, it does not mean something till action is not taken against it. And all of us have to realize that we need to force these corporations and these companies to take action, because they will ban shit. Like, imagine if you put a football clipping online and if it's not supposed to be viewed in your area, it's not going to be viewed in your area.
Yeah.
They know how to regulate this shit.
Yes.
Like, I initially was on their side. I was like, how exactly are you supposed to regulate this? But they know how to do it. Like, if you don't even tag a person on Twitter, right? And you just write their name.
True.
It'll follow that. It'll find that. You can see on their timeline the follow topic concept that is there on Twitter. They don't even have to mention the actual account. They just have to mention the name and I can see that tweet on my timeline.
True.
They definitely have the tech to do it.
They have the power.
They don't. And this has been a corporation thing for 50, 60 years now. They pretend as if they can't do anything about it and they lie to our faces. Like, recycling. I read about this quite recently. Like, this is a bit off topic, but the concept of recycling that is being sold to us, that we have to do it, we barely count for 2%. Like, the world over, the consumer counts for 2% of recycling.
Yeah.
Because it's not in our hands. It's in the hands of the corporation who's telling us to recycle.
Yeah.
So, like, what are we, like, what's, you're lying to us. Isn't that what it is?
Yeah.
That's what is being happening.
Yeah, which I feel, lying to us. Yeah, which makes a lot of sense about the step that Swansea took, like, of not having social media interaction.
Yeah.
For, because if the thing that you're consuming or the platform that you're using rather to like spread your information, and this platform is being like is being used again as a platform through other consumers to like belittle one of their employees, then how is it helping? So yeah, I don't know, like they have a lot of power. They don't want to do anything. Like, it's become...
And you can see their power, man. They banned the president of the United States from their platform.
Oh, yes.
You see how much power these guys hold. And they are not willing to do anything about it. So what has to be done is we have to push them to such an extent that they do not have an option but to do any something about this. Because, like, if I want to, like, right now what it is, if I send Marcus Rashford some abuse on my Twitter account, they'll ban my Twitter account. I'll go and make another Twitter account. How hard is that?
Yes.
There is there are problems. Like, there are some ways that people have suggested that can be done. Like, you have to give your verified information.
I have no idea why that is still not being implemented or like...
No, but there are issues with that also because there are some Twitter accounts that were talking about it. They were talking about like trans communities and gay communities and there are some issues that come up there. So because there's a concept of coming out as a particular... sexuality, right?
Yeah.
So that way there are some complications. I don't understand those complications well enough, obviously, because I don't personally... know a person of that community very well.
Yeah.
I have not had a lot of interaction in those communities. So, but the amount I read, I understand there are issues, but
yeah,
there must be something that something has to be done because...
Yeah, something has to give.
Yeah, and this is unacceptable.
I mean, we who like know very little or know very or have read very little already understand or know what the problem is. And then these corporations... just turn a blind eye, which is like shocking. I mean, where is the world going? It's not heading at
it's
this
not
rate.
Even that shocking, man. It's like if you look back at history.
Look, we just seem to accept that. That's also another one of the problems. So, all right. On that very serious note, let's. Do you have anything to talk about more as we like smoothly? Come transition to the end of our episode.
Okay, let's talk a bit about this Liverpool team, the Champions League winning, the Premier League winning team, and their like, are you saddened by their fall, or are you like in the corner that oh my God, what is Klopp doing, and he doesn't know better, or whatever, like whatever nonsense is being spouted. Like, what are your opinions on Klopp right now, and how he's handled this year?
I think I love Klopp. Like, wow, I would die for that man. I mean, anybody would die for that man. One criticism I have is he is very loyal to his players. So no matter how out of form or what they've done, and then they don't seem to be performing, like loyalty is his biggest thing, like in terms of getting. And that's why, like, as we record today's episode, I think Sadio Mane is going to be dropped for the first time in like forever. Like dropped.
What happened to him?
Dropped. Like his loss of form has just impacted. Like he was the person who drove us to the title. Like,
yeah.
There were a lot of factors coming together, but like he pulled us
off. There's a different energy that Sadio Mane brings. Like, I think N'Golo Kante is one of those players. Like the energy that he brings to your team, and like he doesn't even have to say a word. Like, just watching him do what he does. Like, the other players are so energized and so emboldened. They pick themselves up to a much higher level because this guy is on their team. And I think Bruno Fernandes also does that a lot. Like, Bruno Fernandes is central to everything United does. But I think the most important thing that is about Bruno Fernandes is that he's always there. He's trying something. Even in the big games where people suggest that he's a bottler or he's not a big game player. Like, the man is always putting in everything that he has. And that is the most important thing that you can do as a football player. Like, in my opinion, that...
Yeah.
Like, but if everything that you have is supposed to be on that pitch. And if I'm a manager, that's the guy I'm going to love the most. Because that is the guy who will always think of the team first and him second.
Yeah. But, yeah, having said that, the thing... And the second criticism I have is... He's a very stubborn man. And like which is also like very connected to his loyalty towards players. It was very easy to like know. I mean, he wasn't blind. He was the one who transactioned Lovren's transfer from Liverpool to St. Petersburg. And then clearly know that he has three first team central defenders. And then he chose to like have Fabinho as his fourth backup option. who I feel is the best defensive, who I feel is the best number six in the world, and then you want to play him out of position to fulfill in case there's an injury. So this is my biggest criticism of him. And then he kept trying combinations, different combinations, when and kept having Fabinho in the center back position rather than having him in the best position for what he's the best in the world, rather than trying like maybe a League Two defender in Phillips. But 4 months later, he's starting Champions League game for you. So you've lost that 4 months time. But your second part of the question, like, am I saddened? No, Liverpool is going to... It's again, like the entire episode, we've spoken about context and factors and variables. The thing is, if you go to see like Klopp's career, like 7 years Mainz, 7 years Dortmund, and now sixth year at Liverpool, Klopp got relegated with Mainz. And then, yeah, he left Mainz. And then that's when like he joined Dortmund in Dortmund's last season before the winter break. They were in the relegation zone. They needed that winter break. They needed that reset. That's why then again, they got back to the European positions and then like he quit. And then again, you already mentioned the cycle of rebuilding. So this team has like, has had no fresh energy come their way. So Thiago came, he was injured for three months. And then like, again, like then this season has been like a rebuild. So yeah, a lot of,
especially in this, like in such complicated time, like Thiago is a, like whatever shit has been said about Thiago, like I don't understand that also. Like it's so, like that guy has proven himself over and over and over again. Like how can you question his abilities? You can question his form, criticize his form, no problem. Thiago will be the first one to tell you, I've not played well. He's not been as good as he's supposed to be.
Yeah.
But you are pretending, you're not even pretending, you're fucking lying to yourself by saying that Thiago is not a good footballer or he's not one of the best in the world at what he does. And that's like, I'm like, what is this? Like, where does this come from? Like,
yeah, they are just they're just extreme believers of what they want to believe and close an eye on. But I'm not
like, look at your own personal, look at me as a person. Like you have ups and downs as people, man. Like sometimes you're not at your best. And that's just a fact of life. For us, like we are not in a professional sports athletics thing. So we don't, it's not such so apparent, the slumps and the ups and downs that we go through. But we at least understand, like that much basic understanding as a human being you have, that a human being is not always going to be at their optimum. And sure, that's just what the case is. And that's what the margins of football, elite football are. The margins are very small. They're always going to be very small because it's super competitive. And those guys have big, they're the first people who understand how competitive it is. And just the opinions that people form of players is like Van der Beek also. Dude, that guy was bossing Champions League semi-finals. What the hell are you talking about? Like, yeah, he's not playing well. That's just a fact. But that now doesn't mean that Donny van de Beek is a fraud or a sham or whatever pathetic word.
Yeah, there's this. They also need to think about like some players are world-class players because they can come after an injury of 6 weeks and then just boss the first game back from injury. Some players build their form towards it. And then there are some players who are not helped by the fact that they play one game every 3 weeks. This constant stop and go is
you
never
need that rhythm. Yes.
Yes.
You need that rhythm to be able to build yourself and bed yourself into a side. Yes.
Yeah. So, I mean,
Jesse Lingard is the perfect example for that. Like, just look at him right now. Like, that explains everything you need to be explained about players and how they function and what they need. Like, they need support. They need chances.
True.
They need assurances.
I mean, that's confidence.
Extremely important. Yeah.
Confidence, self-esteem plays a big part.
In clubs like Liverpool and Manchester United, that's a hard thing to come by because the stakes are so high that I can't give Thiago 7 matches with no consequences, or Donny van der Beek a run in the side 5 games or something in a row without regard to his performances in those games. That's just not how it works. And there's a transition that these guys have to make. And give them time to make those transitions. Like, if they have failed, they'll tell you that they have failed and they'll move on. They'll be the first person to tell you. But at least give them that whole period of time to At least
yeah, to show them.
At least let them take a legit shot at it.
Yeah, but yeah, and then like again to continue with your question, I feel like, I mean, 7 games to go, it's a lot for Liverpool to make the Champions League. But I wouldn't be surprised if they won 7 out of 8. Like, no surprise. Like, this is like, again, they needed this international break to like reset. And especially, I don't know how many went. I think
Klopp also needed a reset mentally.
Oh, God. And
it's
the
been an exhausting time, like with his mother and everything.
Oh, and the lack of empathy from the media and like to question, give him stupid questions. Anyways, like, yeah, let's not dive into that.
Well, yeah, he didn't paint himself in glory with some of the ways he answered the questions. Like, but that's fine. That's okay.
I mean, if I lost my mother and if I then keep going to work for the next 6 weeks or even for the, yeah. And if people
yeah,
ask
no,
me,
that's an unimaginable one.
If people ask me stupid questions, of course I'm going to snap at them. So yeah. Again, like,
yeah, but he's a German man in English football. English football is notorious for not accepting outsiders. So,
oh, that's true.
He understood the situation well enough. Like, I'm not.
I think he also gets it about this
media or whatever. But yeah,
he gets it by this point in time. So, like, if he's been asked stupid questions, he is going to give a stupid answer. So he's reached that point in time, and like, I feel most of the talent.
And fair to him, like the fans won't change their opinion on one answer that he gives in a contract.
Yeah.
And that's what matters, right? Like, media is going to say their thing because it's their job. It's their job to criticize you. It's their job to try and find holes in the ideas that you're bringing up.
Yeah.
But Klopp does not answer to the media. Klopp answers to his fans, and the fans are back. Will always back him because of what he's done. He's done what nobody could in the world could do. So
yeah.
Like, yeah, like that does it. Like, Klopp as a Liverpool legend, like the whole thing, I think that's done and dusted. Like, it's on Klopp now if he wants to leave or not. The answer, the fans will not ask him to leave.
Yeah, no, that's beyond, that's
no,
beyond question.
There is no reason for them.
He can do what he wants and like, yeah, have a statue of him, which he of course wouldn't want, but like people would
might
want
it.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
the thing with Liverpool is that they already have a lot of people who deserve their statues.
True. But
have infinite amount of statues around your studio.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, of course you can't. We already put up, like, now we have 2 statues, one of Bill Shankly and the other of Bob Paisley. But yeah, having
Gerrard would be in line for that, and Dalglish should be in line for that. There will be a lot of people in line.
I mean, Dalglish already has a stand named after him, so. Yeah.
Well, Ferguson had both, so I'm pretty sure they could do both for Dalglish also.
Yeah. On that note, firstly, I think we will have a lot to talk about. So I would really love for Anjuman to come back on this podcast again. So
we had a fun conversation.
Man. Yeah. He's already given his word. I was going to ask for it, but he's given it, and we are going to talk about a lot of different topics. Maybe also not like have an agenda, because we drifted a lot from actually having a podcast.
I hope that wasn't a problem.
No, it's of course not a problem. But now that I've realized after doing this is, okay, we don't need an agenda for the next time we do a podcast and talk.
We can have an agenda just to something to fall back on.
Yeah,
right?
Just to transition.
But our conversation was able to work without the agenda. Like, we had listed points and I'm like, I had to, this point came in afterwards and we had to discuss this later. But
yeah.
Then you're like, no, like whatever things he brings up, let's talk about it.
Yeah, of course. All right. On that note, I hope you've reached to this point into the podcast so long. Thank you. Thank you for staying with us. If you loved our show, if you find it informative, share it as much as possible. Leave us a review on Apple Podcasts. Follow us on Spotify and also on Instagram at sports.tales. Till then, thank you, Anjuman, for coming over.
Thanks for having me. This was awesome.
Yeah. And let's talk more about it soon. And until then, guys, stay healthy, stay happy, and ciao, guys. Meet soon.